got to get going. So we need people to know what's going on, what to look for, start eliminating. The other one, they'll probably go with that, not to let the cat out of the bag, is we're going to have a ban on, we used to have people like come down like the burn pile, cut up firewood, stuff like that. We're going to have a complete ban on that because we can't transport that out of here. And so we would, just rather than trying to ascertain is this ash, is it hardwood, whatever it is we're just going to say we're not allowing you to come down and sign the waiver anymore and cut up tree debris down there. We're just going to burn it. That's a recommended way of disposal. We have an old ash board. And so that's what we're going to do. So, but right at the last minute, once we do it, it's here, we're like, we need to full on get information out and start taking care of the city population of the trees. And that will also include planting. That's a main part of the tree board's efforts and other money set aside. This is specifically to deal with them.
Questions on that, or public properties, recreation, or building maps? But we'll move on to planning and zoning. The big item in planning and zoning is our updates to the levy and levy pump house and related revenue source for that. And Greg, if you want to talk about that for a little bit.
Absolutely. As you know, over the last few years, we've been involved with levy accreditation process. So last time Michael Bash from GAO was here, they did the whole assessment, take a look at all the capital items related to it, look at the freeboard and the makeup and design and structural elements, geotechnical elements of the levee. They finished all that and made recommendations. One of the recommendations, other than some slight freeboard adjustment on the top of the levee in certain places, is to look at the structures. And one main structure that's a concern is the pump house. Currently located, I believe, at the end of 10th. On the south end of 10th Street at the levee. Currently, we have three pumps that pump through a concrete culvert structure that was converted. The pumps actually dump down onto a spillway, and at the bottom of the spillway is actually the stop gas gate, correct? And so the pumps dump down into the stop gate, so you wouldn't do this, you would hope, but you're only operating in the middle of a thunderstorm, major flooding, and everything else is starting to go on. But the way that that was designed and structured is just not recommended. The other one is those pumps currently. The Gator pump that we can pull up with the pump back of the tractor can pump more water by itself than those three pumps combined. So you'll see, like during the flooding, you saw us out there supplementing. We have called BNSF. We have to get permission to lay the pump over the top of the rail track to make sure rail isn't coming through. It's kind of a nightmare. So this is an update to the whole system. The other element that's involved is automation. Right now, your system is completely manual. It essentially means that when the storm gets going at 3 in the morning and we know if we have a lot of water in the city, inside the levee that needs to get out, you're really hoping Bob woke up and trudged down there. And I think one of the last few times Bob went down there, shined his headlights on some dumb city administrator that was standing down there staring at him. I was scared of half to death. It's a weird process, and then that time I got to go with Bob as he did it, and you're out there in the middle of the dark in a blazing thunderstorm, everything whipping around you, going up the side of the levee, through the grass, going over the top of it, and then trying to get your way down to open things up, make sure the pumps are on, just whatever it is you're doing. And so a safety element of that and is definitely the automation. And so having it automatically kick on and kind of have the SCADA system or something to oversee that. Bob can sit at home and go, yep, it's on, and maybe he wants to go out there and check it or not, but having a system, and then if there is a problem, it's letting you know, and you head out there and get started on it. So that will be huge. It will also be huge for backup water. I know in the past we've always been concerned, especially with Hughes Brothers, because they're kind of at the top end of that stream, that water would get back into some of those areas. Most of the low-lying areas that are adjacent to the waterway a lot higher, but the backwater that backs up, if that system were to fail or not be turned on in time due to the manual situation, that would have a huge effect on community growth. So we're always conscious of that, trying to look for ways to continue to protect all the assets down the lower part by the way. So, but incredibly expensive, well over $1 million project. We put in through the flood grant, there's a thing called the Hazard Mitigation Grant Program. Jake and I worked with JEO when Jake was here and with Michael Bash. So we recognized this, so we kind of put our best plan together and we submitted it as a hazard mitigation grant. We received the first first round of approval, but it has to get, which is kind of like, hey, this is a great project, we're gonna put you in front of the line, doesn't mean you're gonna get it. And then you have to do a whole ton of work after that to basically pledge the whole project out, do a bunch of studying, we went down and did surveys of different properties and heights and things like that, talked to some property owners about their history of flooding down there. I learned a lot about who owned all those properties previously too, so that was kind of interesting.
Who administers the grant?
I believe that's through, I wanna say NEMA. It's a FEMA grant, hazard mitigation grant. It's similar to the grant that you guys used to buy all of the flood properties, that's essentially the same one. So they just have a new administrative way they do it, and so you have to kind of jump through multiple hoops rather than just sticking an application, see if you win or don't win. So we're waiting to hear back on that. There's tons of funding because obviously that's one of the greatest disasters in the history of the state. A lot of federal dollars came in, so it's good to be upfront and get ourselves in line, and we did that. So we're just waiting to hear the final one on that. And then our other partner on it, so next year you're gonna see the planning portion of it, which will be the planning and design. We're looking to partner with the local Upper Big Blue NRD. They've been great partners with us on the lending accreditation progress so far. We're gonna continue, we're gonna go meet with them in the next month and talk specifically about this project and then see if they'll continue to partner with us on some capital.
Yeah, still going through Mr. Farmer. I don't see any part of that anymore. If that's his name.
Where?
The guy that's ahead of the NRD. Mr. Farmer.
No, I work with Jack Morgan now as my central contact point. So that's planning. That's the big one. And again, it's really weird that there's no place for the levy to fall. It's a general fund expenditure. It's maintained by the street department, but we don't put it in the street budget because the street budget has very specific things it needs to identify and uses for like STP dollars, federal highway allocation dollars, and formulas and stuff that we fill out. And so even before my time back when John Hughes and Ed were here, that's where it landed. And so just to be cohesive, we put it there. So that's why it kind of sticks out. Oh, I hope so too. Otherwise, we'll be back there having a whole different discussion and probably pushing it for next budget year and reducing the scope and size of the projects.
All righty. If there's no questions there, we'll move on to the police. And the main item we wanted to note here was basically that we want we're purchasing a new vehicle basically every year. However, we're purchasing it with a loan or a lease purchase type of financing. And so basically we want to go to where we're just buying one new one outright every year. The cost is similar from when you end up paying three separate loan payments versus just buying one outright. And then we could avoid the hassle of getting financing and also the interest costs related to that. So.
Biggest question, did we figure anything in there for Bercher? Are we going to be affected by that if we do the 911 with radios?
No, it's covered through drug board.
Okay.
Again, as Councilman Singleton noted, this is also where our E911 comes out. We talk about it every year. And so that was presented to you previously and recommended approval, but that is now, that's always tucked into the police budget.
No questions there. We'll move on to the rail campus budget. And basically we just have $30,000 stuck in here available for engineering costs that may arise that can't be done internally. So
if you guys have a project or some sort of planning that goes on that you want to take a look and we can't use internal engineering to kind of give you a design or a scope or something like that, then you look for outside engineering. Other than that, we don't have any capital plans because we kind of, for the most part, built out the portions that we own currently. And so we don't have any other estimated plans or anything going on for that specifically for that first half of the campus.
All righty. We'll move on if there's no questions on the rail campus. In recycling, there's nothing major to note here. the revenues are down just because of the lack of market. Outside of that, I don't know if there's nothing really big or interesting here with recycling this year. So.
Greg, is there anything else you can be doing from a recycling? And instead of the recycling center, is,
dollars we need for the city, but does it pay for us to have a recycling center that we're paying to have people come take away if there's a company out there that'll come drop these bins and?
I don't think any of them will do it for free anymore.
Yeah, I don't know.
It's essentially, there's some associated cost, one way or the other, because there's no market for recycling bins at this point.
But we really need to work with waste management and, you know, submit some bills, because some of this will get paid for from Celine Seward dump. There's monies there that if we submit it and follow the process, and Greg and I have talked about it, we can get some funds back. So something will work.
For those that are new to the council, the solid waste management down in Dilbert, that we're a part of, there's a number of different communities are a member of the organization that holds that together. There are certain funds and fees that put together reimbursements for recycling. And so different communities submit certain costs. Usually all it is they have, just like we talked about or Councilman Schmidt brought up, they might have one collection center in the city that's just one tote or one roll off. They toss everything in, they submit the bill to have it hauled off, and they recoup $100. But for us, with the significant volume we take on, we have a different kind of need for that. So, and then the other one is also, are they being, you know, are you separating it versus there's a significant cost if you don't separate it? And so we're just saying all recyclables go into the tote and then they separate it out. So, but I have done the math. If we try to convert it or, you know, see if we wanted to just make it part of, hey, citizens, we're going to remove this as something we offer, it would be significantly more to the citizenry for just a small percentage of them to pay for it themselves and get curbside. So.
All righty, we will move on then to the senior center. And there really was nothing significant here. Revenues and expenditures are very similar to what has been budgeted and spent in prior years. And so nothing we felt we needed to touch on specifically unless there's any questions there.
All I can do is give kudos to Katrina. I don't think Katrina's here tonight, but give Katrina Goldsmith kudos. She did go out because essentially they're still closed. They're following the recommendations of Aging Partners and coordinating with their other senior centers to kind of have a uniform rollout. And so she had a very limited opening for certain things like hearing tests and some other things like that. So the usage of that facility is way, way down, and the no potato bakes and all the great things that we do to generate revenue over there. And she's done a great job of securing other funds to help fill those gaps in her budget this fiscal year that she's closing out. And she'll probably have a little bit eventually leaking into next year, just looking at what use will look like and that it is a senior center. So until we have a better idea getting out of this pandemic situation.
All righty, we can move on to the street then. And I guess the main thing that we wanted to highlight here was some of the projects, the biggest being East Hillcrest from East Street Avenue to Plum Creek Bridge. I don't know if we need to go any further discussion there.
Yeah, you guys had the 1-6 year plan at our last meeting, and so you kind of know what our plan is. An extension of East Hillcrest, East Ridge approximately, down to Plum Creek Bridge. We want to put in a trail width sidewalk, or approximately connecting up with that southern portion of Concordia and that wider sidewalk to get a nice safe route for pedestrians to take to make in that connection. Right now, anybody that lives over in that area or traverses that roadway, you're usually going headlong one way or the other, and somebody walking up from that trail coming up Hillcrest. So this will do that. The other one was is we had to clear the Carroll Cave project, which kind of kicked off today. That project needs to be cleared out, finished. The federal project then ceases, and then we can go in. We don't want to be mixing in federal projects and us going in, removing concrete or adjusting curb radiuses and things like that, whether in much coordination and the pain. So Mike will get started once the budget's approved in designing that, and then we'll try to get bids out still maybe late this fall for construction next year. that's a big one. I will say long-term though, we need to take a really, really close look at this one. The street budget really long-term is the one where we have a lot of needs, but we really need to align the revenue sources and expectations and stuff. And maybe going and looking back at the well of federal funding projects, try to help assist us or looking for other revenue mechanisms, whether that's annexation, increases highway allocation, which means your annex next to one of the highways, different land, which also may increase your annex dollars and things like that. But looking for creative ways to continue to fund streets, because again, bonding these big projects and kind of knocking the big ones we need to do this fiscal year, looking forward, you know, you're not going to be able to do that sort of thing, so it's going to be kind of one major project a year probably. But we continue to need to look at interesting revenue sources. And it may be great funds and things like that. The flip side of it is, you've seen it in other projects, you tie federal grant funds into things, this is my mantra, I've heard it said a million times, is it significantly slows down projects. And usually with that slowdown, you can increase costs. So if there's a given indication. So keep that outlook in mind as we continue to progress forward, continue on our future 1 to 6 year plans. Reductions in the general fund. We're not borrowing the lower transfer money out of the general fund because the other revenues can't support it.
Any specific questions on the street?
One thing I've never seen, and I brought it up for many years, and Bob, you're new though, is we got the tractors to run it. We have the farm ground that we own in the fall when the crops are out. Why haven't we put in the purchase of a big manure spreader so we could get rid of some of the compost as fertilizer?
Yeah, I agree. We talked about it.
And the other thing is, how many times a year we have to go out there with the fire department and put about 25,000 gallons of water on it. And I'm just saying, I brought it up many years and it's never went anywhere. It would be perfect for the farm ground because it's nice. So this is something I'm throwing out there, and reduction of the potential for a fire. It's great to have in the compost, and we could always get rid of it too in the winter when the crops are out.
I think the best way to deal with it is twofold. One way or the other, you may run into it. And Mike may be able to speak to this from an engineering standpoint, is whether you're taking that and then spreading it commercially in some way. I don't know if you need approvals for that. Or if you actually want to compost it, is looking at the idea of doing what they do, for instance, in Beatrice, where they mix it with other bios. So they take the byproducts of their wastewater treatment process, they mix it, they windrow it, they set it out real nice, and you get the blackest dirt you've ever seen. But either one of those may be regulated by different elements on the state level, so I want to make sure that we're not.
Depends on what farmer takes it and what they have committed to in terms of their specific requirements.
The biggest issue is we own the ground, so there would be MPB or NDEQ isn't going to come back on us as hard because we own the ground. Because we bought the ground years ago through FEMA for flood mitigation. So the city owns the ground.
It's complicated. I think you have to dig into it.
We look into it. It's not something that we're
doing. Yeah, it's not like it's not possible.
Yeah.
Just because of the proximity.
I don't like getting Saturday morning phone calls and, hey, the fire department's out at the compost site again with a nice smoke screen going across BNSF's main line.
I just brought it up. We brought it up for many years, talked about it, but I've never seen it, and that's nitrogen that'd be perfect for the ground.
You could also sell it.
Yeah.
You could also sell it.
Yep. So.
Don't take the compost, by the way, but there'd be ways that we could use it.
All right, anything else on the street? If not, we'll move on to TIF. There really wasn't anything major here. We continue to budget for the anticipated revenues and expenses, tax receipts and related pass through of those tax receipts. Other than that, we've got this amount.
we have to cover the initial costs on any of your TIF projects. We pay Andrew and some of the other associated fees and things like that. Or generally, if we get like a weird TIF question that pops up, but we don't have somebody attached to it maybe, then that's just on us. And so that's what we hold that budget to get those questions answered.
That's really all I have on TIF, unless there's any questions there. And we'll move on to wastewater. And in wastewater, we're recommending a 3% rate increase. Again, this is our recommendation, which is in line with NMPP. And Greg kind of spoke to the their process of coming up with their rate study and how they cut that to us. There's three major projects. I don't know if you want to talk about those, Greg, or?
Let's see, I can get two of them. And we'll see if I'm missing out on the third one. The first one that's going to be teed up, and it's already started, you will see bid documents for this to go out for bid, is the outfall. And so the relocation of the wastewater treatment plant outfall, currently our outfall after the entire process is done, and we're putting out pretty decent water, goes out to Plum Creek right now. It's the closest body of water directly to the wastewater treatment plant. That's how it was set up. Well, just across the other roadway, is the Big Blue River. Big Blue River is a sizably larger body of water, and so our permitting, if we were to discharge into the Big Blue River, would be different. And with that different, basically profile across a number of measurables, and Tim's, I think Tim's back. Tim?
Yeah.
He's here. He could speak to it, but essentially, by putting into that larger body of water, all those rates can go up, and that makes our current system more efficient. We don't have to bring certain things down to certain levels. We can have higher levels, which means we can push through the process faster. And so that prolongs also the life and the timeline of our current wastewater treatment plant as we begin to step into the next giant project, which is a new wastewater treatment plant. We discussed this before, leading up to well before the rail campus and everything else. You guys had put together a 20-year capital plan, I think almost 10 years ago. It's over 10 years ago now that we've been working through it. That 20-year plan had certain expectations about growth in what we did with wastewater and everything else. Well, it trended up way faster. Seward saw faster growth and larger growth and usage within the city. And so you kind of hit your 20 at year 10. And so that precipitated the discussion again of a new wastewater treatment plant. It just so happened that it came in line perfectly with the development of the rail campus and now a new user that's going to help contribute on the wastewater side in regards to rates, which is that source. But our growth, as it continues to grow, even residentially, is not sustainable at the rate just the residential growth is. It has already precipitated and presented the need for a new wastewater plant. And so in this year, we have budgeted in there some of the design planning elements, and so you'll go through what will most likely be an RFQ process to look at different engineering design groups to then come back in and make a selection. You'll put a team together and then make a selection on a firm to then begin the process of starting final design. We have an initial plan that we have approved before, but you need a definitive like design plan drawing from a firm that you then take for construction to put out the gate. And so that would be the next step. That's where we're going on that. And then in the meantime, coming up and continuing to find revenue sources so that we can deflate or offset the capital costs on that, because it is significant in the future. And so you may even want to look at, in regards to the rate study, starting to offset a capital fund or a sinking fund just specifically for that, start building up revenues to not make such a big hit when we get to that point. So I've seen that done in other communities. That's what they do, is it's just an infrastructure fee that the people, when they get their bill, they know exactly that this extra $1, $1.50, whatever it may be, goes directly into preparing dollars to be spent into that facility to bring down those costs up. We also have work that we're doing that Mike and Tim and I are helping on to secure funds from the state to offset. They have really low interest rate dollars that they're setting aside for us. But the more grant funds and other funds that we can generate, then we're going to get those interest costs, which on a 10 plus 12
AMR system.
And so they're one third, they're, I believe a quarter of the AMI system. It's also people that, again, they don't directly use it. We extrapolate from their water use in the winter time, off the meters to give you your sewer rates. And so they're still benefiting from it, so we felt it was appropriate to assess some costs to that utility.
And then equipment wise, they're getting a new, a new combo jetting truck.
Probably the hardest working piece of equipment, in the fleet for water or wastewater is the jet truck.
Are they trading?
What?
Are they trading the old one in, or are we keeping?
Tim?
They give us the option of trading it in, but we have some buyers that are interested in buying it straight from us. They're trading, I think they're looking at $35,000 for the two units, the old vac and the jet truck. We're looking at about $45,000-$50,000 to sell ourselves. That would be the market that they said they would sell it for if we traded it.
Is that a guarantee though, that they're gonna buy it or not?
They're in high demand because we're constantly getting requests to borrow.
Yeah.
It's a, you know, I spoke just yesterday on a different issue. We were talking about some utility planning and stuff. I spoke to Administrator Beatrice, and they have one of these trucks for water, electric, and wastewater now. Because they're in such high demand for their use. They're not just go and suck out or blast out wastewater lines. There's a whole flood of uses that you can use it for. It's a non-aggressive way to get into to doing some construction work and not interrupting or digging into certain other utilities when you don't know what you have and things like that. So a really, really utilitarian kind of piece of equipment that will allow us a ton of use. So a big pickup for us, but inexpensive with that.
Any questions on wastewater? Move on to water then. There's no recommended increase on water, and again, that's in line with the NMTP rate study from prior year. And there's a few different projects going on, so I don't know if you want to run through some of those, Greg.
There'll be a portion of the North 6th Street water main project, as you know, we already had a discussion about the projects and their timelines and stuff. So a portion of the project that's underway now, $150,000, we estimate, will move into October. We're working on the Southwest well replacement. This is essentially our Dakota well, correct, Tim?
Correct.
We've been looking for an additional well to help supplement all our other well systems. We originally were looking at the Southwest well field. We went out and did a test well to look at getting into what is known as the Dakota Aquifer. Dakota Aquifer is a basically lower, deeper aquifer below the wall.
Right. Yep.
And the Dakota Aquifer has a completely different nitrate makeup and makeup across a number of different measurables that we treat for. And so we initially did a test well out by the water treatment facility right there. Out directly out west by the railroad tracks, we hit no groundwater, correct?
At 510 feet, we hit no aquifers at that location.
Zero, which is concerning. So Tim and I kind of looked back at it and looked where we knew other Dakota aquifers were being hit on different wells, and we kind of saw it to the east and to the south. Milford,
yeah,
is one of the towns that accesses it.
Yeah, we do know the golf course has a Dakota well that's 460 feet deep and has excellent water quality.
Do we have records, Tim, of the old wells we went out and probed? Because I know we hit high flow water there by a treatment plant years back, but I think the nitrates were so high. There was something in there right there at the heck of right by the ditch, if I remember right.
To the west of the water plant?
Yeah.
Yeah, very possible. I mean, you'd be so close to it,
right,
you could miss it.
I'm just saying, if you had old records, you know, Tony Verana's time, you know, because he was a big water person. We drilled and we used to put so much money a year to go out and put wells in to see if we could get water. But I know right there was high flow well.
Well, ultimately what happened was we went to a test well this year then down in the south well field.
Mm.
And that's because we kind of extrapolated where we were seeing big hits on the Dakota based on the wells that we could get information on. And it looked like it was south and east of us. There's a lot of hit. And so the tip line of the section down there and the southwest from the south field. And they did hit it.
Yeah, we hit it at 370 feet and we went to about 460 feet. Didn't go any farther than that, but there's a really good volume of water right in that area.
So if that pans out, we'll use these funds to then build a well facility in that location, hopefully. But we need to continue to do more testing. The hope is with that, the makeup and what we find in the testing of that Dakota aquifer is that we'll be able to use that water to continue to blend at the wastewater or the water treatment plant, which then continues to reduce the load on the water treatment plant, prolonging that system for more years to come, and not exacerbating, bringing in another tier.
It'd be nice if we could go back and find those old records because so we're not hitting going for the same place we were before.
Yeah. Well, we went to the engineers in the state and they said they have no records in that area, but that doesn't mean there isn't some well company that could have some records there.
Guy thought it was Sargent.
Yeah.
It's like 2011, I think. Tony was telling
me. It's a greater expense going deeper to try to find these wells, but it should be less expense once you find the water because it's going to be less contaminated with nitrates and other aspects that you have to take out anyway. So that's what Greg's talking about blending it. That's what he's talking about. It's better quality water. Fire quality issue as well.
And then one of the
currently the water quality of the golf course nitrates is zero. And Milford at this time has three Dakota wells that were drilled by Sargent Drilling. And that's where they're getting, they're not treating their water at all except for some iron issues. That's not it, so.
They have a completely different profile when you get that deep, you're concerned about other things. The last one is just the new water tower that's part of the water plant. So gearing up for that one and final discussions on placement of that. So kind of briefed on that one, but that's been in the works for the last year. That's the big ticket out of the water.
All right. Should we go ahead and look at the airport detail?
Yeah, it's part of your budget, so we can kind of hit on the airport real quick.
Yeah, they have a portion of our levy. Tax revenues went up with valuation as well. Other than that, they have their hangar project that they're doing right now. Their hope is looking like that will almost, if not entirely, be funded through grant dollars. So they're hoping to not have any debt related to that. That project's extending this year, and should hopefully be done in the very beginning of 2021 year. So, that's, I guess, the main item there. I don't know if there's anything else.
Do they have questions on the airport?
Specifically talks about projects that each of the department heads have lined up and want to do or need to do over the next 5 years, 6 years for street, and kind of as a planning tool for us to look at it, kind of see things.
Any other questions from the council? Otherwise, this is a public hearing, so I'll have the public comment portion of the public hearing. Does from the public wish to comment on item number one? Seeing no one, I'll go ahead and close the public comment portion of the public hearing. Is there anything else you need to do on this item at this time, Greg?
Is this the portion where you'd like to make those adjustments?
Want me to read those out, or how?
Try number one, is your action on item one?
You have the resolution, the adoption, or you have to restrict?
That's two.
Yeah, those are two.
Yep, we'll do it then.
Yep, so is there anything else you need on one?
Other than if somebody wants to get in some details, because now's the time, because we have the details in front of us.
Any questions or comments from the council on item one? Is that Ellen?
Greg, what would be the cost of a 1% COLA?
I believe me and Nick did a look at that, $42,000 is what we estimated based on current salaries.
I'm uncomfortable going with zero. I mean, I get what the formula says, but anybody who's been to the grocery store recently has seen prices go up significantly. Among other costs, and a lot of people are, you know, without work or having work cut back, dealing with schooling issues. We also like to retain our great employees because they do a great job, and we sometimes have trouble recruiting employees for certain departments. So I don't know if anybody else would be interested in entertaining a 0.5% or a 1% COLA increase. And I know that the comparables and the formula, and I get that, but I think we're in a new world here this year. And a small increase to show our appreciation and our value, at least.
I agree with that one.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to prolong the discussion. I will note that you saw it in the budget memo also, that due to the fact that we had this 0% increase last year in healthcare, and the 0% increase this coming budget year, the three elements that make up comparability are wages, health insurance contribution by the city, and then retirement. Retirement we don't mess with a lot. You don't see big swaths of changes in that number or percentage. It's usually floating around that 6 to 8%, and usually cities are always static. So the biggest movement you see is in wages and healthcare. But with other cities seeing larger and larger contributions to their healthcare because they have increased healthcare premium costs, they're being absorbed by the city. With us taking a zero, it's great for now, but once we get to full comparability, you're gonna see coming up, and I mentioned the budget, that we're gonna lag behind, and so the element that you're gonna adjust, again, you can adjust any element of the three, but likely the one you're gonna wanna look at is wages. By doing a COLA, you do continue to kind of push those up to compensate for the health insurance, so you're not so far behind when you do comparability. I would
hope
that.
And from an administration standpoint, we're perfectly fine with doing that. We just felt somewhat hamstrung by the recommendation of how, here's the formula, here's what you want, here's the period you want to look at, and it came back at like 0.1. So we have no issue with doing it either way. It's just to follow that formula, that's what we ended up with, and you obviously have the discretion to increase that to whatever you feel is appropriate. Just so that's why we didn't come in recommending anything higher.
You know, and when the Finance Committee met, and this has been a couple years ago, and you were new, Greg was new on board, it was kind of like, it was just a number that was always thrown out there. So we said we were going to tie it to something, and so we tied it to something with the option, obviously, of what Ellen just introduced, for us to have the ability to choose a COLA when it is at a zero. And so I think it's
do I make a recommendation or a motion or?
Well, I think when we get to
number two,
item two, we have some resolutions and some adjustments that Nick is going to. So at that point, we'll probably appropriate.
Can you figure out figure out what fit it in.
Because it's going to hit all of them if we do that, so there will be some adjustments, I think, a ratification of the next meeting, Nick, of the final numbers. I've talked about that. You guys really wanted to go and have some fun with us, change up a bunch of stuff, you'd be ready at the next meeting to ratify and finalize that, so we will do that.
Any questions or comments on the item number one in the council? If not, I think we go to item number two, Greg. The second public hearing with the resolution and ordinance?
Yep.
Okay, so item number two, this is a public hearing, notice of special hearing for the purpose of hearing support, opposition, criticism, suggestions, or observations of taxpayers relating to setting the final tax request at a different amount than the prior year tax request. Greg? Or Nick? Nick, you want to take that?
Yep, so this is basically part of the budget formula. When we do the state form, the council has to basically request this 1% additional restricted funds. Allows us to, trying to think of a good way to describe this, Greg.
It pushes further the restricted funds than what you would do normally. This is something you've approved in almost every municipality across the state, approves every single year to just give you restricted fund authority, so.
If we don't do this, I think it can create some potential problems.
Yes, you can hamstring yourself on some of your other problems, but it's just giving yourself authority. So the recommendation of us is we've approved every year I've been here for as long back as I can remember that we've approved this, so to give that increase in restricted funds.
Before we keep going through this, why don't you do the public comment portion, then we can go through the items individually. I'll open the public comment portion of the public hearing on item number two. Is there from the public wish a comment on item number two at this time? Seeing no one wishing to comment, then I'll close the public hearing, or the public comment portion of the public hearing, item number two. Do you want to go through each of these, or do you want to just do A, you just discussed the approval of an additional 1% increase in restricted funds. Do we need a motion on that then?
Yes.
Any questions or comments from the council? Would someone like to make a motion?
I'll move to approve the 1% increase in restricted funds.
You have a motion, is there a second?
Second.
You have a motion and a second? Any further discussion? Please call the roll.
Beck?
Yes.
Camper?
Yes.
Singleton?
Yes.
Miller?
Yes.
Schmidt?
Yes.
Holderman?
Yes.
Wilkins?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Item B, this is approval of 2020-2021 municipal budget and authorized the filing of budget forms. I think, Nick, you have some adjustments you want to make, and we also have the COLA.
Yep. You want me to just read
yep,
those out?
Read real quick, so
okay.
On the record.
The first item is adding $2,000 to the cemetery fixed asset line for the purchase of two mowers in total for next fiscal year. The second item is moving $60,000 in the pool fixed asset line to next year for the building to house the new heater. In the Parks and Rec budget for the Armory Park Jeep from this fiscal year to next fiscal year.
We also have the 1% COLA.
The last one would be the, and I don't know if you want to vote on that one separate from these, or if somebody wants to move all of them together.
I will move all of them together.
Again, the 1% COLA is across all salary budget line items. Equates to approximately $42,000.
Kelly, do we need to, is this motion then to, is to basically accept these amendments, and then the second, will be a second motion after that to actually approve the budget?
As amended.
As amended?
That'd be good.
Okay, so the first motion then, if that's okay with you, is just to make these amendments, okay. Is there any, we have a motion and a second, is there any further discussion on that? Seeing none, please call the roll.
Beck?
Yes.
Camper?
Yes.
Singleton?
Yes.
Miller?
Yes.
Schmidt?
Yes.
Calderman?
Yes.
Wilkins?
Yes.
Motion carried.
So now item B is the approval of 2020 to 2021 municipal budget and authorized filing of the budget forms as amended. Is there a motion?
Move for approval.
Second. We have a motion and a second, is there any further discussion? Seeing none, please call the roll.
Beck?
Yes.
Camper?
Yes.
Singleton?
Yes.
Miller?
Yes.
Schmidt?
Yes.
Calderman?
Yes.
Wilkins?
Yes.
Next, item C is resolution for the 2020 to 2021 property tax request different from property tax requests for prior year. Nick?
Yes, so just that the property taxes request is different from the prior year, and that's just because of the valuation.
Adjusting the levy as we've done for the last number of years, but we're riding and taking that excess additional revenue from valuations going up.
Any questions or comments from the council?
I want to introduce the resolution.
Okay. The resolution has been introduced and is designated as resolution number 2020-36. Would anyone like to move that this resolution be passed and adopted?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Please register your, or I'm sorry, please call the roll.
Beck?
Yes.
Camper?
Yes.
Singleton?
Yes.
Miller?
Yes.
Schmidt?
Yes.
Calderman?
Yes.
Wilkins?
Yes.
Item D is an ordinance for adoption of the municipal budget to appropriate sums for necessary expenses and liabilities to provide for an effective date and include an additional 1% in restricted funds. Do you want to add anything, Nick, or is that pretty self-explanatory?
Pretty self-explanatory, and basically this is the process of filing the state form budget.
Any other questions or comments from the council, or is it asking to introduce the ordinance?
Yeah, I just got a question. Greg, you said that we'll be talking about this one more time in 2 weeks. How does this affect that?
This won't affect anything. You'll bring back the final resolution numbers that have like all the dollars, which, as you amended, because we don't have those in front of you right now.
Okay.
So we will.
And really, it's just a matter of just a matter of looking at and restating the total expenditures of the city.
Yeah.
So say whatever total is now versus whatever it is.
And then we'll also reprint that in the paper then.
Yep.
To follow, because we printed in the paper all the stuff related to this budget hearing. Now that you've amended and changed it, there'll be a follow-up in the subsequent filing.
Okay.
That one in 2 weeks will basically check all that off.
Thank you.
Any other questions or comments? Or would someone like to introduce the ordinance?
I'll introduce the ordinance.
Right. An ordinance to adopt the budget statements to return the budget and annual appropriation bill to appropriate sums for necessary expenses and liabilities, which includes an additional 1% increase in restricted funds, to provide for an effective date, to provide for publication of this ordinance in pamphlet form. The ordinance has been read by title and is designated as ordinance number 2020-17, and the title is hereby approved. I need a motion to suspend the statutory rule.
Second.
A motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? Seeing none, please call the roll.
Beck?
Yes.
Camper?
Yes.
Singleton?
Yes.
Miller?
Yes.
Schmidt?
Yes.
Alderman?
Yes.
Wilkins?
Yes.
This is ordinance number 2020-17. Would anyone like to move that this ordinance be passed and adopted as read?
So moved. Second.
Motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? Seeing none, again, the question is, your ordinance number 2020-17 be finally passed and adopted. Please call the roll.
Beck?
Yes.
Camper?
Yes.
Singleton?
Yes.
Miller?
Yes.
Schmidt?
Yes.
Calderman?
Yes.
Wilkins?
Yes.
Motion carried.
This is our only ordinance for this evening, so I need one final motion to make this ordinance a part of the permanent record.
So moved.
Motion, is there a second?
Second.
Motion and a second. Please call the roll.
Beck? Beck?
Yes.
Camper?
Yes.
Singleton?
Yes.
Miller?
Yes.
Matt?
Yes.
Alderman?
Yes.
Wilkins?
Yes.
Thank you, everyone. Under administrative items, consideration of funding agreement with Seward County Chamber Development Partnership. I heard Jonathan Jenkins here this evening.
Yes.
Welcome, Jonathan.
Yes, thank you, Mayor. I will be here tonight. Ed Foster, who is the current chairperson of our organization.
We're gonna move out of the way so you're not staring at us.
So thanks for the opportunity to present this evening. I want to say specific thanks to the Seward City Council for their investments in the Seward County Chamber and Development Partnership with their time on the board and financial support of our organization. Special thanks to Councilmember Helen Beck and her continued commitment and time and dedication to our board of directors. She represents Seward very well on our board, and we're grateful for her efforts. I'm going to briefly review our public sector funding agreement with the council to display our compliance. That's the first document in front of you. The funding agreement was signed from October 1st, 2019 to September 30th, 2020, so we'll be finishing up this month. The city's annual investment was $67,500 in the Seward County Chamber and Development Partnership for the fiscal year of 2019-2020. And it was spent towards the operations of the SCCDP and according to Nebraska statute. The public funds were and are segregated in a separate bank account. The funds have been used only for the purposes of economic development. There was an annual audit conducted within 60 days of June 30th, 2020 to ensure compliance with this agreement. Proof of that audit will be emailed to you soon. We actually officially approved it at the board meeting yesterday. We'll have signatures and send that out. We'd like you to consider renewing your support of economic development efforts in Seward County through entering into a new funding agreement and public membership agreement with the SCCDP for your upcoming fiscal year. I'd like to briefly highlight some of the economic development projects we've been working on in 2019-2020. That's the second document that was attached. These